Good afternoon, everyone. Oh, yeah, come on in, come take a seat. Thank you all so much for coming out to the Buckley program's last event of the spring semester. My name is Alexis Gerganius, and I'm the speakers director of the William F. Buckley Junior Program at Yale. Before I introduce our esteemed speaker, I would like to say a few words about the Buckley program. The Buckley program is dedicated to the intellectual diversity and free speech on Yale's campus. We achieve this goal in a number of ways, including speaker events, firing line debates, our annual conference, in summer internships for Yale undergraduates, and various other activities. For any pre-frosh interested in learning more about the Buckley program or becoming a Buckley Fellow, please come find me or our president, Josh Altman, at the end of this event. Now I have the privilege of introducing our guest for this afternoon. Dr. Yuval Levin is the founding editor of National Affairs. He earned his PhD from the Committee on Social Thought at the University of Chicago, and he is the Hertog Fellow at the Ethics and Public Policy Center. Dr. Levin is a contributing editor to National Review and the Weekly Standard, and before that, he worked on the White House domestic policy staff during the Bush administration and also as a domestic congressional staffer. He is a prolific essayist, and his essays have been widely published. His recent book, The Great Debate, Edmund Burke, Thomas Paine, and the Birth of Right and Left, has been widely praised, so I recommend you all read it. We are fortunate to have Dr. Levin as our guest, and after he has finished speaking, we will have some time for a Q&A as microphones will be passed around. So now, without further ado, speaking on What Are Conservatives For?, Dr. Yuval Levin.
Thank you very much. Appreciate the introduction. I appreciate the invitation. It's it's really an honor to be at the Buckley program and at Yale. I've spent a fair amount of time at Yale for various reasons, but it's actually the first time I've gotten to see the Buckley program in real life. I've heard a lot about it, and it's widely admired, I have to tell you. It's really wonderful to be here. I appreciate being asked. I thought that I would use the opportunity that you've given me to speak with you to take up a question that's a little bit off the news, or would seem to be at first, in an effort to make a little more sense of what's on the news, in part because what's on the news when it comes to our question of what are conservatives all about is not all that encouraging to me lately, and so I thought it might make some sense to step back and think about what conservatives at their best might be about and how that relates to what's going on now in our politics and how we might want it to relate. The question, what are conservatives for, could be taken in a couple of different sorts of ways. It might mean, what are conservatives good for? What's the point? And in that sense, certainly a lot of us on the right have been moved to ask that question, some in the Obama years. Are we achieving anything? Are we advancing something worthwhile? Are we succeeding in some meaningful way? And if not, what are we for? What are we good for? Or the question might mean something more like, what do conservatives favor? What do they want? What are we trying to conserve or to achieve? And I think many Americans at this point might be forgiven for asking that question because conservatives just haven't been very clear with the country about the answer. This primary season and the Donald Trump phenomena that's dominated it, at least on the right, has forced us to see what's otherwise too often been ignored on the right, which is that conservatives and Republicans are not always the same thing. There's a powerful and important conservative faction in the Republican Party, but that faction doesn't own and define the party, and in turn, the party doesn't own and define conservatism. It's not the case that whatever the Republican electorate happens to cough up at any given time is what conservatism means. And it's also not the case that conservatism can just mean opposition to whatever the left is doing at any given point, or at least that can't be all that it means in our politics. In the last few years, conservatives have fallen into an oppositional mindset for understandable reasons. We've had good reasons for doing that. The agenda of the Obama administration has been moved by a political philosophy that we've taken to be hostile to a lot of things that we believe in, and pressed on various kinds of questions from religious freedom to the place of civil society to foreign policy, we've responded defensively and tried to defend some ground that we believe is important to protect. That's a right and appropriate response under the circumstances, but it can't be enough. It's not enough, first of all, as a political matter, since it doesn't tell other Americans what we have to offer or what we're trying to achieve. But more important, it's not enough intellectually and philosophically, and it contributes to an impression of American conservatism that I think some conservatives themselves share, that conservatism is a kind of brake on American life, while the left holds the steering wheel. The liberals push the country in their kind of social democratic direction further and further, and conservatives try to keep our government from costing too much or from growing too big. And that means that liberals are working from some idea of what government ought to be, and conservatives seem to have in mind only an idea of what its size or its scope ought to be. And voters could be forgiven under those kinds of circumstances for imagining that conservatives just think that the liberal welfare state should cost a little less or grow a little more slowly. And that's certainly one impression you could walk away with from the kinds of fiscal debates that we've seen in the Obama years. But in reality, the chief concern that ought to motivate, and I think always has motivated, American conservatism is not a worry exactly about the pace of change in American life or even about the size of America's government. It's a concern about the character of American society and the role of the state in the life of that society. Clarifying that point to ourselves and making that case to the public requires that even in the heat of an election season, maybe especially in the heat of a particularly hot election season, we try to reconnect with that vision of American life, that understanding of the human good that drives us into politics. And it requires us to translate that vision into concrete policy and politics. It requires, I think, a kind of political program that draws on a conservative vision, a conservative anthropology and sociology, even a conservative epistemology, an approach to what we can know about society, how we ought to solve problems that can then express itself in terms of practical governing questions. And by working our way up from those kinds of deeper roots toward the surface of American political life as we know it, we can start to see the shape that that kind of 21st century conservatism might take. And that's something like the start that I want to make briefly in these sort of opening remarks this afternoon. In a sense, what or how do conservatives think? As I say, for me it starts with a kind of anthropology. And I think that American conservatism has always involved a variety of different schools of social and political and economic thought bound together in some ways. But they're all, or nearly all, united in a general sense by a kind of cluster of anthropological assumptions, assumptions about the human person. Conservatives tend to see the human person as a fallen, imperfect being, prone to excess, prone to sin, always in need of self-restraint and moral formation. It's a kind of dark view of human possibility, at least a skeptical view. This fundamentally, maybe even gloomy conception of man, rooted certainly in Judaism and in Christianity, distinguishes conservatives from both libertarians and progressives, for the most part, in our politics, and sits at the core of a lot of conservative thinking about society and politics. It leads, to start with, to some low expectations of human affairs. It leads away from utopianism. And in the modern history of the West, conservatism often has expressed itself as an anti-utopian creed, unwilling to believe that timeless human problems could be permanently resolved by some kind of novel insight or clever system or transformational leader. The most profound, the deepest human problems recur in every generation because they're somehow intrinsic to the human person. They're a function of our permanent limitations that have to be acknowledged, have to be counterbalanced, mitigated, accommodated, but they never quite go away. And the fact that these limits are inherent also leaves a lot of conservatives persuaded that the experiences of different generations will not be fundamentally different from one another. Or as some people have put it, that human nature has no history. That leaves conservatives not only resistant to the lure of utopia, but also a lot more concerned about the prospect of social and cultural degradation than we are confident about the prospects for enduring progress. Regardless of how much intellectual or material progress any society might make, every new child that enters that society will join it with basically the same native intellectual or biological equipment as any other child in any other place at any other time in the history of the human race. Raising such children to the level of their societies is, to put it mildly, a distraction from the forward path. If you've ever spent much time with a three-year-old, you know what I mean. And a failure to initiate the next generation of children into the ways of our civilization, to rear our children, not only would delay or derail innovation, it would put into question the very continuity of our society. That's why conservatives rarely imagine that we're on the verge of utopia, and frequently, maybe too frequently, imagine that we're on the verge of dystopia. And it's a crucial reason why conservatives care so much about culture. And this same assumption, rooted in those low expectations, also often leaves conservatives impressed with enduring, successful social institutions. The fallen character of man means that, left to itself, the default condition of humanity is a lot more likely to be miserable than happy, that failure in society is more likely than success. And so conservatives are often a lot more thankful for success in society than we are outraged by failure. Liberals tend to feel differently because their expectations are higher. They are more open to the possibility of the perfectibility of man and tend to think that they have a formula for it. So the persistence of failure tends to infuriate. Conservatives get outraged too. We've been outraged a lot lately. But it's generally at seeing something valuable lost, while liberals more often are outraged at the obduracy of the status quo. An appreciation of a gratitude for what works in society, an inclination to address our failures by building on what works rather than starting over, gives conservatives a high regard for long-standing social institutions, those that have been valued by generations of people who've dealt with the same kinds of basic human problems that we face. It's a key reason why conservatives are traditionalists and are inclined to be protective of established ways. And those customs and institutions that stand the test of time, which is really a kind of recurring trial and error process, generation after generation, are likely to be best adapted to help us address timeless human problems and meet enduring human needs. They're likely to possess more wisdom than we know, more wisdom than any collection of technical experts is likely to have. And a lot of the knowledge they have, and therefore a lot of the knowledge that our society has, is contained in the structure of those kinds of institutions. And so it's conveyed not just as knowledge, but as practice. This kind of understanding of the place or the significance of enduring institutions takes us from the anthropology of conservatism to the sociology of conservatism. The conservative vision of society is informed by a low opinion of the capacity of individuals alone to address social problems, and at the same time by a high regard for the rights and freedoms of those individuals. So it looks for social arrangements, for institutions that counterbalance human failures while respecting human liberty. And it tends to find those in what we call the mediating institutions of a free society, the institutions that stand between the individual and the state. And these are central to the conservative approach to society. And appreciation of these middle layers is one of the things that most clearly sets conservatives apart from progressives. American progressivism, from its earliest incarnations, has been characterized by a deep suspicion of, and maybe hostility to, these mediating institutions. It's viewed them as lacking in democratic legitimacy, as conveying little more than prejudice and backwardness, precisely because they're not rationally designed, but have evolved gradually the way traditions do. They've often struck the modern left as vestiges of a pre-democratic time, at odds with the logic of a modern politics. This view has separated conservative from progressive strands of liberalism from the earliest period of our political tradition. It's not an inherently illiberal view at all. It follows from one particular reading of the very liberal tradition that conservatives are trying to conserve. But in just that way, it highlights the fact that our left-right divide is an intra-liberal difference, and that a lot of our political debates are fought within the bounds of our political tradition, even when they take the form of struggles about the authority of tradition itself. Thomas Paine, who was surely a great champion of liberal principles, was one of the earliest exponents of the view that's now common on the left, that society needs to be understood as consisting largely of individuals and a government. All the layers in between, he argued, are remnants of a darker time and have no place in the political life of a genuinely free society. All that those sorts of institutions involve, he wrote, is the contrivance of a great distance between the individual and his rights. And that artificial chasm is then filled up with a succession of barriers or turnpike gates through which he has to pass. End quote. That's Paine. What Paine did not see, but a lot of his more radical successors have seen, is that defining society as simply individuals in a government that represents their interests leaves little room for common action that is not state action. This is one of the paths by which a kind of radical liberalism transforms itself into a statist progressivism. Clearing out the space between the individual and the state clears out the means by which people exercise their liberty and opens the way to arguments for vast expansions of the role and power of government. A lot of contemporary progressives certainly do see that, and they frequently make arguments for government action that implicitly assume, without expressly defending, this kind of view of society. So, for example, in his second inaugural address in 2013, President Obama argued that the demands of a changing world make a greater reliance on government unavoidable. I'll quote, and by the way, President Obama's second inaugural is very well worth reading. It's an extremely intelligent speech and really one of the clearest articulations of the progressive worldview that I think we've ever had from an American progressive politician. He says this, "For the American people can no more meet the demands of today's world by acting alone than American soldiers could have met the forces of fascism or communism with muskets or militias. No single person can train all the math and science teachers we'll need to equip our children for the future, or build the roads and networks and research labs that will bring new jobs and businesses to our shores. Now, more than ever, we must do these things together, as one nation and one people." Our options, in other words, are a single person or one nation and one people. Utter individualism once might have been sufficient, the president suggests, but it no longer is, and the only real alternative is national action. Both the view of the past and the view of the present that's implicit in that argument are very much at odds with the way conservatives tend to think about society, and both share in the same underlying view, a rejection of the mediating layers of society. Those layers have always been central to the conservative understanding of social life. It's an understanding that grounds liberal rights and duties not in radical and abstract individualism, but in a rich sense of the way in which our social arrangements evolve toward a greater understanding of permanent truths and of the importance of the intergenerational means of that evolution. It's been maybe nowhere better expressed than in Edmund Burke's response to exactly the radical liberalism of Thomas Paine. In the course of an essay called An Appeal from the New to the Old Whigs, written in direct response to Paine, Burke wrote this in 1791. I quote, and it's a slightly long paragraph to quote, but I really think it's probably the most important paragraph in all of Burke's many volumes of writings. He says this, "Dark and inscrutable are the ways by which we come into the world. The instincts that give rise to this mysterious process of nature are not of our making, but out of physical causes unknown to us, perhaps unknowable, arise moral duties, which, as we're able perfectly to comprehend, we are bound indispensably to perform. Parents may not be consenting to their moral relations, but consenting or not, they are bound to a long train of burdensome duties toward those with whom they have never made a contract of any sort. Children are not consenting to their relation, but their relation without their actual consent binds them to their duties. Men come in that manner into a community with the social state of their parents, endowed with all the benefits, loaded with all the duties of their situation. If the social ties and ligaments spun out of those physical relations which are the elements of the commonwealth, in most cases begin and always continue independently of our will, so without any stipulation on our part, are we bound by that relation called our country, which comprehends, as it has been well said, all the charities of all. Nor are we left without powerful instincts to make this duty as dear and grateful to us as it is awful and coercive." End quote. I say this may well be the most important paragraph in all of Burke's writing because it sets out the links between a conservative anthropology rooted in the limits of the individual's power and choice and a kind of conservative sociology that expresses itself in the complicated social topography of the life of a free people. It helps us see a stark distinction between what we might think of as the right and the left on several levels. First of all, it's crucial to see that this kind of sociology begins from family obligations that highlight the inherent limits of the power of choice in the human experience. An enormous portion of the conservative worldview becomes clearer in light of the importance that view places on the basic facts and character of human procreation. It might be an odd place for Burke to start, but it actually is exactly the right place if you think about where his thinking goes. Cultural continuity is a function of generational transmission and the inescapable responsibilities that are imposed on each of us, on every generation, by its place in the middle of a chain define some key features of every human society. And an enormous portion of the progressive worldview becomes clearer when we see the degree to which it's shaped by a desire to be liberated from exactly those obligations and from the basic facts and character of human procreation. Many of what we've loosely come to call the social issues in our politics actually involve debates about whether that kind of liberation is possible and desirable, whether the word choice could be poured like an acid over traditional social arrangements, burning all the links of obligation and duty, and making responsibility optional. And it's no less crucial to see that exactly the social topography that Burke describes stands in the way of that kind of liberation. That's why the flattening of society has so long been essential to the project of the more radical elements of the left, that view it as a necessary prerequisite for genuine equality, and so for justice, both in principle and in practice. The sociology of conservatism, which understands society, as Burke says, as kind of spun out of the family and the community and the endless array of mediating social structures that shape relationships among individuals, suggests that justice, both in principle and in practice, has to be pursued through our evolved traditional institutions rather than around them or in spite of them, because those institutions answer to the enduring character of the human person, again, to exactly the anthropology that we've just looked at. That correspondence between the human person and the complicated social institutions that give our society its form, a correspondence that results from generations of gradual social evolution, means in turn that the alternative to the mediating institutions of our society would be something like synthetic and artificial social structures created by exercises of technical expertise, empowered with state authority. In other words, the alternative to our traditional mediating institutions would be something like government programs rooted in the sociology of progressivism. We live with a profusion of those kinds of programs now. They're the pillars of the liberal welfare state, intended both to stand in for and to weaken the pillars of our traditional free society. Those programs were by no means designed with malevolent motives. Each is expected to answer a very real social need that might have been met by one of those traditional mediating institutions in the past, the family, civil society, religious groups, the market economy, but which progressives for various reasons came to believe could no longer be met by those traditional institutions, and so now had to be addressed by an application of social scientific expertise. By replacing a function of the traditional family or work or civil society with a public program designed to meet the needs of individuals while minimizing the social pressures put on them, progressives hope to liberate the individual from a kind of undue reliance on other people. Dependence on people you know is oppressive, this kind of vision suggests, especially because it always comes with moral and social strings. But dependence on larger, more generic, more distant systems of benefits and rules is liberating because it frees people from undue moral influence of traditional social institutions, even as it frees them from material wants and allows them to have the lives they choose. A healthy dose of moral individualism combined with a healthy dose of economic collectivism makes for a powerful mix of freedom and equality. And this mix should be achieved through public programs and institutions that address material problems by applying technical knowledge. Conservatives have always resisted that kind of rationalization of social life and insisted that local knowledge, channeled by evolved social institutions, would make for better outcomes and a better common life. The life of a society consists of more than moving resources around. And what happens in that vital space between the individual and the government is at least as much a matter of character formation as of material provision, wealth creation. Moral individualism mixed with economic collectivism feels like freedom because it liberates people from responsibility at both ends. But real freedom is only possible with real responsibility. And real responsibility is only possible when you depend upon and are depended upon by people you know. In other words, only possible exactly in that space between the individual and the state. What happens in that space happens face to face, between parents and children, between neighbors and friends, between buyers and sellers. Therefore, it can sometimes answer to immediately felt needs. It can be tailored to the characters or sentiments or priorities or preferences of the people who are involved. That kind of bottom-up common life, rather than massive and distant systems of provision, is what makes society tick, what holds it together. While it can certainly be reinforced by public policy, it could never be replaced with centralized administration, however capable or rational that might be. The sociology of conservatism is therefore a sociology of traditional and decentralized social institutions, evolved over time rather than engineered. the anthropology that yields that sociology of conservatism therefore also leads, finally, to what you might think of as an epistemology of conservatism, the right's theory of knowledge, and for all the reasons that we've already begun to see. The left's high expectations of the human person point toward a social vision that has a lot of confidence in the capacity of rational design to liberate people from responsibilities and obligations. It can do that by consolidating and applying knowledge in the hands of the only truly legitimate institutions of common action, government institutions, and then applying that knowledge to addressing social problems. Conservatives begin from very different premises about human possibilities that leads us to a much higher regard for evolved traditional social institutions and to a much lower opinion of the potential of consolidated technical knowledge. It therefore leads conservatives to look for solutions in more bottom-up ways, by looking for ways to allow people to try different ways of solving problems, that is, to experiment on the ground, letting the people who need solutions choose among those options or experiment and evaluate solutions, and finally letting those decisions matter, letting the ones that work be kept, the ones that don't be thrown away. Markets are, in a sense, ideally suited to following those steps. They offer people a huge incentive to try new ways of doing things. The people who are directly affected decide what they like best, and what they like is kept, what they reject falls away. Government programs tend not to work that way. Administrative centralization or regulation tends to stand in the way of experimenting with different solutions. The people who need help are generally not the ones that choose what sort of help they get, and failures never go away. They build up interest groups around themselves, and they're retained. That's why conservatives often reach for the model or the language of markets in public policy. Not necessarily always for actual markets, but for a process that follows these steps to the extent that they can be followed in different policy arenas, and so achieves incremental improvements by learning from experience on the ground. Conservatives tend to think that society is just too complicated to be amenable to consolidated technical solutions that assume that we already have all the answers and just need to impose them. We therefore believe that long-evolved and decentralized social institutions are just more likely to be able to help, and that public policy should reinforce those kinds of institutions, should help citizens take part in them, should sustain the space in which they can function. What's come to be called a conservative reform agenda in the last few years basically involves different ways of moving from the welfare state model to a more market-oriented or mediating institutions model in different arenas of public policy. That's what school choice involves, for example, or what the conservative approach to healthcare looks like. It's what the right has to say about reforming welfare or higher education. It's where conservative ideas point on the full range of domestic policy questions. Allowing providers to try different kinds of options, allowing citizens to choose among them, and allowing those choices to matter. That's how what we might call the epistemology of conservatism points toward a particular approach to public policy, an approach that's rooted expressly in the anthropology and the sociology that define the conservative worldview. And that approach to policy is also rooted, finally, but maybe most importantly in some ways, in an ideal of human liberty. And here, too, conservatism has a unique contribution to make in what is really an intra-liberal debate. The idea of liberty that too often permeates our political debates now is rooted in a kind of radical anthropology that has too high an opinion of the character and the rationality of the human person. Progressives and some libertarians, too, in different ways, both imagine that by liberating the individual from all outside constraints, we could set free what are basically his noblest instincts and eradicate some of our greatest social problems. Both tend to take for granted a human individual that's capable of handling an enormous amount of freedom and responsibility. But that kind of person rarely occurs in nature. More often, that person is an artifact of a particular kind of culture that tries to shape citizens capable of living as free men and women, of aligning our desires with our duties. When we fail to see the need for that kind of culture of moral formation, we imagine that all that's required for a free society is the absence of coercion, and so we're liable to seek, through politics, through public policy, to neutralize the public square of any moral content. When we see instead that our free society requires a flourishing private culture of moral formation, we're inclined to prize and to defend the institutions that engage in that kind of formation. And those are, again, the mediating institutions that fill the space between the individual and the national state, and that speak to the innate and simultaneous nobility and iniquity of the human person in personal terms. A conservatism that's committed to the future of the free society, grounded in a sense of the limits and the dignity of the human person, and an appreciation of the virtues of the mediating institutions, in a grasp of the means by which society improves its knowledge and solves its problems, would try to protect the space in which those mediating institutions function and give them more freedom and more power to help them recover their strengths so that our country might do the same. Every plank of the policy platform of today's more policy-minded reforming conservatism tries to do that, to inject greater, more meaningful power into the space between the individual and the state, and so to help American society address its practical problems in a way that also reinforces its capacity for liberty. The goal of conservatives in national politics can't just be to have less of the same, to have the liberal welfare state at a lower cost. That too often has seemed to be what conservatives have argued for. The goal, rather, should be to transform American government along conservative lines into a government that works to sustain and to expand the space between the individual and the state, to strengthen the family and civil society and the market economy, and make their benefits accessible to more Americans, to help the poor not with an empty promise of material equality, but with a fervent commitment to upward mobility, and to strengthen the middle class by lifting needless burdens off the shoulders of families and workers. That kind of government certainly would cost less than the government we have now, but it would do more than that. It would advance the vision. It would advance a vision that not only stands in the way of progressivism, but builds on the best of what America has been, and on the foundations of the conservative view of the human person and society, by showing Americans why that kind of approach would improve their lives in practical ways. To advance that sort of vision, conservatives have to do a lot more than oppose. We need to offer our own idea of the good and a clear sense of how it might translate into a vision of government that would improve the lives of the American people in practical ways. That's the only way to start the hard work of winning the public's trust again. And winning that trust is both the only way to oppose what has conservatives so worried and to bring about the kind of revival that all of us want. To say that this is not exactly where the right is at this point in this election year would be a gross understatement. So you have to wonder what this ideal, this philosophical vision of conservatism really has to do with the reality of a Republican Party that now is cavorting with the likes of Donald Trump. The answer to that question, I think, is the difference between principle and practice, and so in a sense also between conservatism and the Republican Party. A vision of the good is not the same thing as a political platform, but it acts to guide that platform, to help citizens tell the difference between movement in the right direction and movement in the wrong direction. A time of uncertainty, of frustration and unease, when the direction of our politics, even of American conservatism itself, seems awfully unclear, is exactly the right time to return to principles, to get back to our intellectual roots and clarify for ourselves what we believe in and why. What emerges from that kind of work can help to set the standards for making judgments. As Abraham Lincoln said of America's founding ideal, that sort of vision in politics can be, quote, a standard maxim for a free society, which should be familiar to all and revered by all, constantly looked to, constantly labored for, and even though never perfectly attained, constantly approximated, and therefore constantly spreading and deepening its influence. It's important, in other words, to think about what we want when we think about what we can do next, to think about what the goal is, what the ideal is, before we can offer the public practical steps forward from here, so that we can even tell the difference between what moving forward and moving backward would look like. I can think of no better time than primary election day here in your state and in my state of Maryland to ask ourselves, what are conservatives for? It's not a question that has been easy enough to answer this year. And some of the answers out there strike me as decidedly the wrong answers. And so this really is the time to think about what good conservatives can do for the larger society, what we have to offer, what other Americans who don't start out where we start out might have to talk about with us, to think through with us, where we can meet them part way, where we can try to persuade, and how. That ought to be the way that we confront this difficult political season. And so I thank you very much for the opportunity to take up the question with you. and I'm eager to see what you think. Yeah, and tell me who you are, too, if you don't mind.
Thanks.
Democratic capitalism, which seems to be unfortunately in great disfavor in the political world today.
Yeah.
By way of one example, I believe to this day the fiscal crisis is still primarily understood among the public as a bunch of deregulating Republicans and greedy Wall Street bankers, when there's a real strong counter-narrative that it was bad government policy, affordable housing on the cheap, which opened the doors and the sluice gates to what subsequently happened. How do we recapture that narrative? How do we convince folks there is a different way of looking at these things? Because despite what seem to be those facts, it's very hard to get that story out.
Yeah. Well, thank you for your question. If you couldn't hear, the question is really how can friends of the market, I think it's fair to say, speak to the public's understanding of how our economy works and to a lot of misunderstanding about the role that markets play and the role that governments play in some of the economic challenges we faced in the economic crisis of 2007, 2008, 2009. Thank you for the question, and I agree very much with the premise of the question, which is that a lot of Americans walked away with, I think, the wrong lessons from that quite serious crisis. It seems to me that part of what we saw in the wake of the crisis is that the best friends of market capitalism can also be its worst enemies, because they don't often enough think about the roots of the market, the benefits of the market, the reason why markets make sense in a free society, what they really stand for, what they really mean. It speaks to something I tried to get at in these remarks, which is in a time of crisis, it makes sense to try to return to our roots and ask why we believe what we believe. And at the root of market capitalism is not some ideal of collected selfishness adding up to the public good, or some other caricature of what capitalism stands for. Capitalism is a moral system at the same time that it is an economic system. And it has been, at least since Adam Smith, understood as a moral system that is the natural companion to liberal democracy, and almost a kind of necessary companion. Smith saw it as advancing a kind of human character that's especially essential in a free society, as giving us practice in being responsible free people, because the market creates incentives for people to be responsible, for people to be reliable, to be honest, and so both for owners and for workers, if you want to think in those terms, the market economy is a way of giving people the right habits without forcing them, without coercing them to have those right habits. But that means that the market economy has to be kept within certain bounds by a regulator. And especially for the friends of the market, there has to be an understanding of what the purpose of that regulator is. The purpose is to sustain competition, because at the end of the day, competition is the way that the market economy functions, both as an economic system and as a kind of moral political system. The purpose of the regulator is not to protect domestic producers, it's not to protect politically powerful players, it's not to protect the wealthy, but it's also not to protect the wealthy at the expense of the poor, but it's also not to protect the worker at the expense of the employer. It's not to choose sides at all. It's to guard the rules so that competition can help us make progress. That's a very important role, and it should not be underestimated how important it is, how essential it is, that we have a regulated market. Markets are not natural phenomena. They don't just arise of themselves. They're social creations. But we've almost entirely forgotten what the actual purpose of the regulator is in the economic system. And so we have a debate about whether the purpose is to enable abstract economic growth by allowing entrepreneurs and business owners and large corporations to have their way, or whether it's to enable a kind of material equality at the end of the day by making sure that the product of the market economy is distributed evenly. Neither of those things is really the right way to think about what the political economy of a free society ought to look like. And so I think the politics that followed in the wake of the crisis were a sign of trouble and a sign of very great confusion. And, you know, we need a better rooted defense of the market. You see it in some places. Some people do understand it. Even some politicians do understand it, but not nearly enough. And it seems to me that making that case forthrightly, not being ashamed of it, making the argument for it, and look, that system, that market system that allows competition to improve the human condition has lifted more people out of poverty than anything else in human history. It doesn't always speak in the kindest terms, it doesn't always explain itself in the most appealing ways, but at the end of the day, it's done more good for people in need around the world, and is doing now more good for people in need around the world than anything else that the human race has ever tried. And it ought to be defended on those grounds and understood in those terms. And, you know, I think we don't do nearly enough of it.
I agree completely with your diagnosis and your prescription for modern society.
Well, thanks. But, great question.
Yeah. But what, in the wake of the practicality of the seeming acceptance of national authority and direction, I don't see how we can practically get out of this at this stage of existence.
Yeah, well, that really is a great question, and thank you. I think I disagree with the premise. I would not describe the political mood of the moment as an acceptance of much of anything at all. And I wouldn't describe it certainly as an acceptance of the authority of the national state or of centralizing institutions. I think the public is in a mood of great frustration and unease and anxiety, and is in that mood for a variety of complicated reasons that open up all kinds of opportunities. Our politics now is incredibly dark and gloomy. I mean, if you listen to the rhetoric of this election year, it is unbelievably unhappy. And look, there are serious problems to think about, but the rhetoric goes far beyond those. And it's not only unhappy, but it's deeply nostalgic on both the left and the right. I think that liberals talk about the economy and society in terms that look back to a kind of mid-century high point that they see America having declined from. There's a sense, you'll often hear the president say, and others on the left say, that the economy has been failing the middle class for 40 years. As an empirical matter, that's just crazy. That's absolutely not true. But you can see what they mean, that we certainly have moved from a moment at mid-century in the 50s and 60s where there really was a combination in America at the same time of a kind of liberalizing society in social and cultural terms, beginning to liberalize, and a highly regulated economy, and a global economy in which America was just unbelievably dominant in the wake of the Second World War, that gave workers of all sorts, of all skill levels in our country, incredible opportunities. That's not where we are now. The world has changed in some important ways, and American society has changed in particular by fragmenting, by fracturing, the kind of broad consensus and the kind of incredible faith in large institutions, to get back to the terms of your question, the trust in institutions that Americans had has been absolutely shattered. The University of Michigan every 4 years asks the same question of a very large sample of Americans. They ask the same set of questions, a large survey of American attitudes. One of the questions they ask is, how often do you think the federal government does the right thing? All the time, most of the time, some of the time, none of the time. The combination of all the time and most of the time got 72% of Americans in 1964, just before the 1964 election. Just before the 2012 election, they asked exactly the same question, and 11% of the public gave the combined answer, all of the time or most of the time. There's been an unbelievable loss of faith, not only in the federal government, but in all large institutions, in the banks, in American journalism, in the academy. Americans do not trust our social institutions. In part, that's justified. Our institutions have not proven themselves worthy of the kind of trust they had. In part, it's also just a function of growing individualism in our society, of less of a sense that we are defined by these large structures, more of a sense that each of us should try to be what he or she is individually. That's just what our culture is now. And it's dramatically different from what it was half a century ago in that respect. I think that opens up a lot of space for talking to the American public about an approach to government that is also bottom-up and customized and individualized and decentralized and tries to solve problems in public policy in the way that we solve problems throughout the rest of our society, which is by giving people loads of options and letting them choose. That's what conservatives have to offer the country now. And I think it would be a very attractive offer because our government, unlike all of our other institutions, is still stuck in the industrial economy model of the first half of the 20th century. And it seems to me conservatives have an enormous opportunity, but they're not trying to use that opportunity. Instead, they are one of our two parties of nostalgia. They offer just a different brand of nostalgia than the left does. And I think there is room now for a conservatism that offers itself as a form of modernization, genuinely, legitimately, that could have a much better chance with younger Americans.
So thank you so much.
Thank you.
Speaking of nostalgia and modernization, I wanted to ask you about the history of these ideas. So the roots of conservatism, from the epistemology to sociology, I think you can make an easy case for how they fit throughout the American experience, founders and Tocqueville, and even how they trace back to Burke, who many have called the first conservative. But are they even older? Is it too far to say that they were present in the Magna Carta, in the hereditary law of English courts and equity?
Well, sure. You know, there is a way in which conservatism is a kind of common law approach to social life. And in that sense, I mean, this was certainly Burke's view. In that sense, these are ideas that have been alive in the English tradition that became the Anglo-American tradition for a very long time, almost from its very beginning. Now, when we say that conservative ideas in America are rooted in Burke, I think it's important to be specific about that. I don't mean to say that they're rooted in Burke because American conservatives read Burke and are persuaded. That's not the case. They're rooted in Burke in the sense that they are maybe most clearly and explicitly articulated by Burke. But I think they arise on their own in a free society. They're one of the two obvious ways of thinking about what a free society is for. And there's a reason why there tends to be, in broad general terms, a left and a right in liberal democracies. It's not always two parties. Our particular political system encourages two parties. But oftentimes there is a very clearly identifiable left and right that thinks in roughly these terms, that's divided by how optimistic or pessimistic it is about what human individuals can achieve, and it builds on that, a traditionalism versus a kind of progressivism. And that happens almost as a function of the shape of our society. Burke gave it voice in an especially clear way, so I think he helps us understand ourselves better. But not in some kind of genealogical way. I think you can say the same thing about the English tradition, and it has always been alive in the American political tradition. But it's important to say so has progressivism, right? There's a view on the right that progressivism is some kind of German import, right? That somebody read Hegel at just the wrong time, and then they came back and they ruined everything. Progressivism has always been part, really, as we know it, has always been part of the American experience, and a kind of radical idea of liberalism as the American idea has always been part of the American idea. So if you read the Declaration of Independence, it begins with a very radical set of ideas, and it then proceeds into a very conservative assertion of grievances. That the one might be read to say, this is new. This is a brand new country with a brand new idea. We're a break from the past. And the other says, these are what we believe, and the British have denied us them, even though we've had them for 200 years in the American colonies. There is, in other words, a progressivism and a conservatism at the same time, right there in the Declaration of Independence. I think that's always been true of the American political tradition. It's why it's been kept in balance this way, and it's why it's been combative this way, and it's why it's really had two parties almost from the moment of its birth. As much as the founders didn't want parties, they already were divided into parties. So, yes, I think these ideas go very far back. They go back, I mean, you can think of some of the distinctions between Plato and Aristotle this way, let alone English common law. But the form they've taken in our tradition, the form they've taken in our kind of liberal society, you know, I think can really help us think about the nature of our public debates, why we argue about our public problems this way.
Hi, Dr. Levin. My name is Reid DeBiche. I'm a junior in the college, and thank you for coming to speak with us today.
Thanks.
I'm particularly struck by the point of departure that you have for a view of human nature, that we're fallen individuals that are naturally inclined toward excess, that need to be restrained in some ways. And I'm wondering, how does that view of human nature correspond to kind of the conservative idea of international relations and perhaps the legitimate uses of American power in the world?
Yeah. Well, thanks for the question. It's a great question. So the starting point, the kind of anthropology, is, as I suggested, quite gloomy. It's skeptical of ultimate solutions because it believes that there are just enduring vices that don't go away. They're always going to be present. And your question is that expressed in a certain kind of conservative foreign policy? I think it is, but I don't think that that kind of cashes out in any obvious answer to what should America's foreign policy be in the eyes of conservatives. It certainly does involve a skepticism of utopianism. I mean, that's common to conservatives, period. And I think that the argument that some forms of conservative foreign policy, say, in the last 10 years have been utopian, is not exactly right. I mean, it doesn't pay enough attention to what actually was the argument, say, for the Iraq War, whatever we think of in retrospect. But without question, well, I shouldn't say without question. In my opinion, there certainly has been an overreach in the direction of a kind of confidence in our ability to export institutions of freedom to other societies that would have struck a lot of the people in the tradition I describe from Burke on as dubious, as hard to believe. And you don't really have to guess. I mean, Burke himself makes this argument about British policy in India. He's very doubtful that you can just export political institutions to a culture in which they did not themselves arise. And so that's not to say I know what Burke would have thought of the Iraq War, but the argument that democracy as such can be exported strikes me as at odds with some basic conservative assumptions. I think it's a problem to line that up with the kind of worldview that gives us most conservative domestic policy. So there's a tension there that has been remarked on for a long time, and you know, part of the reason it happens, it seems to me, is out of a need to articulate, to justify an argument for an approach to foreign policy that can be a lot darker than that, that can really be about managing dangers and risks and doing hard things and facing up to threats that we would rather ignore. It's easier to make the case for doing that by arguing for utopia than by arguing for having to uphold this burden on behalf of global security. Maybe that's one argument for it, but the tension is very real. I agree with you.
I was wondering. I found the presentation of, you know, an intellectual conservatism very compelling, and in language that I'm accustomed to hear in conservative circles on a campus. But given that, you know, conservatives in some sense are on the defensive among the elites of our culture and who, you know, control most of how the main political culture of the lower levels. How should conservatives try to engage with a culture that seems to be moving out of touch with these basic observations about human nature and sociology? Because I've seen something of a tendency to try to speak the left's language and try to get the win on their terms. Is that a misguided project to try to play their game?
Well, you know, I don't think anybody owns the language, but it does seem to me that conservatives should be a lot more forthright in explaining what we believe and why, which we don't do very much. Now, I would not say that liberals or progressives do it all that much either. There's a lot being taken for granted in our politics, but the cultural dominance of the left means that when no one's explaining themselves, the left does tend to win. So it's much more incumbent on conservatives to articulate why we think what we think and why it should be attractive to other people. There's a kind of embarrassment on the part of conservative politicians to say that their ideas would help you. They would actually help you. They're not just abstractly right or a form of constitutionalism. They would lower the cost of living. They would make it easier for you to raise your kids as you would like to. These are attractive things, and if conservatives didn't think that our ideas would actually improve people's lives, it's hard to see why you should wake up in the morning and try to advance them. And so it's constantly stunning to me how rarely the argument is made that this is a view of things that we believe to be in line with reality for these reasons, that we think might improve people's lives in these ways, to be persuasive and not possessive. And I think that's so even within the Republican Party. One of the things that the Trump experience should teach conservatives is that conservatism and the Republican Party are not the same thing. There are a lot of Republican voters who aren't really conservatives. They're Republicans for other reasons. They hate the left, or they're some kind of populist nationalists, and they don't think that there can be a home for them on the left. Conservatives should try to persuade them first that conservatism has something to offer them. And in fact, this is how conservatives took over the Republican Party. There's a lot of reference and recurrence to Reagan and Reaganism, and everybody says they're the next Reagan, and that's great. But part of what Reagan actually did was persuade a lot of Republicans who just weren't conservatives that what he was offering made sense from their point of view. Since the 80s, conservatives have felt like they own the Republican Party, and so they don't need to make these arguments, and instead they can treat people within the party who don't quite agree with them as heretics or as embarrassments. That's just politically nuts in a democracy. And, you know, you always have to be persuasive. You always have to offer up what is attractive about your view of the world. I think that progressives on the left are more in the habit of doing this because the Democratic Party understands itself much more expressly as a kind of coalition of factions. And so progressives, the people who are ideologically liberal and in the Democratic Party for that reason, are used to talking to other Democrats in these ways, to explaining why what they offer would be good for people who represent labor, or would be good for the black community, or would be good for immigrants. They're not ashamed of saying that. That's why they're in it. That's why they believe what they believe. They think it would help people. Conservatives believe that too, but they're way out of the habit of explaining things that way. And I think a lot of the trouble that conservatives have and are having in this election year is about falling out of that habit. So I think we just need to do this. Whether it's at this level, talking to college students, you can say epistemology and all that. Fine, don't do that. But in whatever way you do it, this kind of argument has to be made to the public. That is, we believe these things for serious reasons that you should consider, and we think it would help the problems you're dealing with. Either we believe that or we don't. If we don't, then we should be in another line of work. And if we do, then I think it might not be a bad idea to let people know.
Thank you very much again. I think my question really follows from the last two about the kind of national narrative, the way the meaning of the country's history is understood. I see a kind of patriotic progressivism as kind of an easy sell in a way, because it's easy to say there's this egalitarian logic inherent in the founding that was sort of wasn't fully articulated, wasn't fully lived up to, but that we are actualizing throughout history. And you see this in the progressive lineage from Wilson to Letter from Birmingham Jail to Richard Rorty to the current president. And I see kind of on the intellectual right an acceptance of that to some extent, often, and saying, well, Maybe we should just root and branch reject some of our history because it goes in this direction. And so how can we sort of avoid both of those and give some kind of American story that is recognizably in accordance with this vision?
Well, I'm curious what you mean in the latter point about rejecting portions of our history because they don't fit the story. But I certainly agree that progressivism is at its most attractive when it offers up this kind of narrative of American history. And President Obama does this very well and very frequently, basically arguing that there were radical principles stated at the outset. We haven't been able to live up to them until now, and now we can and should. And American life is a kind of journey. Again, read his second inaugural. It's exactly what it is. It is that argument precisely. What it ignores is that at the core of the American founding, and therefore in the shape and structure and function of America's governing institutions, is not only a set of principles about equality, though certainly those are there and are vitally important, but also an understanding of the constraints of human nature, a sense that the human person isn't simply up to radical principles applied directly, but that we always have to be constrained and that power is inherently dangerous and that freedom is a kind of balance between liberty and order. As I say, that's in the Declaration of Independence right after the principles. It's also absolutely at the heart of the Constitution. And progressives do tend to skip the Constitution in that big journey that America takes and tend to see the Constitution as a constraint. As a constraint on the ability of government to advance the kind of vision that they want to see advanced. In a sense, the way conservatives understand how that vision applies in practice is exactly in enabling people to live up to their potential in that space between the individual and the state that's so essential to the conservative worldview. And we tend to understand the Constitution as guarding that space. And so conservative metaphors in thinking about social life are about space. And progressive metaphors are about movement. And I think that's why we think so differently about the Constitution, where on the left the Constitution is seen as a constraint, and on the right it's seen as a liberating instrument because it creates that space and sustains that space. Those are both arguments about American institutions and about American history. They're both rooted in a certain set of truths about America. But I do think that the fact that at the beginning are both the principles and this very constrained view of human nature, you can't read The Federalist without walking away with a very gloomy sense of what the human person is. You sort of look behind you in the street after you read The Federalist. I think that's in our institutions for a reason. And so conservatives could certainly do a better job of articulating that logic. I think it's one of the most impressive things about our institutions, the institutions of our particular liberal democracy, is that they take seriously these concerns, and so they make it possible for us to stay free. But, if our politics were a competition of two attractive visions of American history, I think it would be better than it is.
First of all, thank you so much for this talk, and I found the characterizations of progressivism and conservatism both very compelling. And I want to ask about identity politics, which I think is an increasingly common feature of leftist discourse. And I want to ask, do you think that's a natural feature of progressivism? Because it seems to buck the trend of both the sort of individual freedom character of the left and the sort of absolute collectivism from the government.
Yeah, it's an interesting question. I think of identity politics as an expression of a kind of radical individualism. Identity is not community, right? Identity is a kind of marker that you hang on individuals. And the difference between identity and community, I think, is really at the heart of a lot of our social debates now. And so it seems to me that identity politics is a way of empowering people to fully express their own understanding of their own self in the way they live in society. It's very attractive. It is a kind of natural conclusion from some of the most attractive premises of life in a free society. I don't think it's the right conclusion, but you know, it's a radical extension of some of those attractive and important premises of individualism. So it seems to me that it is a natural expression of the left's individualism. It is at odds some with the kind of centralizing tendency in government, but not quite. I mean, radical individualism and administrative centralization always go together. They're not opposites. They need one another, right? If there are only individuals and a national state, then the only way to meet the needs of individuals is the national state. Think about that quote from President Obama. It's very much about individualism and a national state. Conservatives are about the middle space, neither individualism nor the national state, but community, what actually happens in an interpersonal way among people at eye level, in the family, in civil society, in the church, in the economy. And so I don't think that radical individualism and a kind of political collectivism are opposites. I think they're just two sides of the same coin.
Okay. We have time for just one more question.
Yeah, please. Go ahead.
Please tell me how you or I or we or some group of people can give some identity and body to conservatism, which is now outside the language of politics, politics being the system for surfacing this. It's something that is, and I promise I'll stop after seven more things, words, something that is simple, positive, tangible, independent, fair, dependable, and modern. And you might say, I told you there's no utopia.
Yeah. Okay. Nice, easy question to end on. Look, in a way, I think it gets back to one of the prior questions, and it seems to me that conservatives now have an opportunity that is a greater opportunity than we've had in a very long time to talk to the public in the language of 21st century life about what we have to offer. Because what we have to offer is a way of thinking about society that looks for solutions from the bottom up. And to speak to the public in that way, to understand conservatism as a means of modernization, of revival, of recovery, it seems to me would be both true of it and attractive to the public. Now, it would take more than people like me. It would take more than sort of nerds to talk about this to the public. It would take politicians who think this way and therefore talk this way. Right now, there are not a lot of those people. The ones that do exist, though, are young, and that's good. So I would say one of the big differences between the two parties now is this kind of generational difference. So the Republican Party's leaders in Congress, for example, look a lot like the Democratic Party's voters, and vice versa. The Democratic Party's leaders are elderly, and they struggle to speak in the language of 21st century politics. Listen to Hillary Clinton. She means well, but she is struggling to speak in the language of the 21st century. Listen to Paul Ryan. He doesn't struggle so much. Listen to Mike Lee. Listen to Ben Sasse. These are up-and-coming people. They're just starting. But they are, you know, in their 30s and 40s. They're at home in the 21st century. They've always lived in a country that's very diverse and fragmented. They don't begin sentences with what happened to my country or I don't recognize my country. They recognize it. And that's just more attractive. And they're more likely to be in a position to speak to the public in the language of contemporary life than frankly, the leaders of the left are. I mean, look, I mean no disrespect in saying it, but there's only one person among the Democratic Party's national-level politicians who is an attractive figure between the ages of 30 and 65. And he's already the president. So they don't have a lot to draw on. They don't have a bench at all. They're choosing between a 68-year-old and a 73-year-old. That's not a good place to be. And so, you know, I think Republicans aren't choosing that well, don't get me wrong. But looking ahead, they have a lot more options to work with of people who are, I think, capable of both understanding what they have to offer in this way and speaking in this way. So there's some cause for optimism on that front, I think.
Thank you.
Thank you.